Okay, so let me briefly finish what I was saying last time about invariants. This is the case of what we call partially observable groups, which will be unlike rotation. This is the case in which you have translation, for instance, and so you cannot see the whole transformation from minus infinity to plus infinity. You look at part of it through a window, which is really the window through which your the cell, the complex cell, or the unit in the network is doing pooling. And the bottom line is that there is invariance within a certain range of translations inside the pooling window. And that range is determined essentially by, in the case of translation, by the width of the template, the intuition is. And so mathematically, the condition is that this dot product between the image and the template goes to zero for transformations, so translation shifts large enough of the template. Remember that the image, in order to have invariance, has to be contained in the pooling range. Okay, so it turns out that if you want to have simultaneous invariance to translation in space and translation in scale, so in spatial frequency, turns out that the maximum range of invariance in both simultaneously is obtained by templates that have the smallest support simultaneously in X and frequency. And such functions are known to be Gabor functions, which come out of the, this is very similar to the uncertainty principle in quantum mechanics, because this is maximum localization, the maximum localization simultaneously in space and frequency are given by Gabor functions. So in this case, the templates that give you the maximum simultaneous invariant to shift in space and scale are Gabor functions. And that may be one computational reason why Gabor functions appears in primary visual cortex and are also used or appear in the first stages of visual processing in many systems in computer vision, including deep convolutional learning networks. Okay, so let me go to a similar situation in which we can get approximate invariance to transformations that are not groups. Typical one would be the rotation of an object in 3D, and the transformation is from 2D to 2D. So it's not a group, but locally the transformation can be linearized. So very around a certain point, the transformation becomes approximately an affine transformation, a combination of translation and rotation and especially scale. And so in order to be able to do this, to that this happens, you have to have that the and I don't go the detail of the derivation, but the result is that the templates have to transform in the same ways the image transform. So the template in this case, unlike the first case, where in the previous case, the templates had no condition, could be anything, and the Gabor ones were optimal in terms of range for any object. Here, depending on which image you have, you want to have template that transform in the same way. So for instance, for faces, this would mean templates that transform under rotation as faces. This essentially almost implies it has to be another face, the templates. And and then again, there is a condition of sparsity in the dictionary. You want to have, or localization, you want to have, let me give you a concrete example. So the idea is that if you want to have invariance to rotation of a face, you want to recognize a face, ideally independent of whether how much is rotated. I've seen it only at one view, say frontal. I would like to recognize it also other views. I cannot get this exactly, but I can get something approximative if I have templates, other faces, for which I have all the rotations. And then I use exactly the same algorithm as always, which is I'm given a view of the new face, I do the dot products with all the templates, I pull across them. And this will work if there is this sparsity condition, which means that if I have frontal faces, frontal view of these templates, the dot products with the new view, suppose the new view is frontal, will be non-zero from all or some of them, but the dot products of the other templates, other views than the frontal one, will be very small or close to zero. That's the sparsity. And experimentally, this is true. There is a reasonable sparsity in images of, for instance, of faces, the different views. But then, of course, the algorithm does not need to know this sparsity or so. If you just use it in this case when this condition happened to be true, will work. Here is what it means it works. Without this pooling stage, this is an HMAX algorithm. It's shown a frontal view of a new face, and then it's shown other views of the same face intermixed with other faces, as to say, is the face I've seen frontally or not. And as you can see from these curves, this is performance in recognition. It can, at about, I don't know, 40 degrees rotation, it cannot recognize anymore. But if you do this pooling over templates or views of other faces, then the generalization is much better. It's not perfect, because perfect would mean that it's there at one. But yeah, that's the essentially this condition of sparsity, so that if you have a template here, different views, you will want to have a dot product which is non-zero only for views that are similar to the point of view of the image, and otherwise zero. So you want to have correlation with the between the template and the image when around essentially the same or similar rotation angle. And so this also gives this hypothesis about cortex that in the first stages in V1, V2, V4, you have generic, possibly Gabor-like templates that can be used for any kind of object. But then when you have to deal, or the system has to deal with non-group invariants, non-generic invariants, it's beyond translation, rotations in the image plane and scale, then when you want to deal with class-specific invariances like rotation in depth of a face, smiling of a face, change of expression, changes of pose of a body, and so on, then you have to have neurons, synapses that are tuned to this class of objects, to have templates that are specific for the different classes of objects, because they transform in different ways. Okay. And so this is the kind of picture, the primary visual cortex and up to maybe IT, you have kind of generic templates and coming from this sparsity condition, and otherwise you need template that transform like the class of objects. And the idea could be that you have clusters of neurons. Here was a simple model of how through development an animal like a monkey could cluster together templates that have similar properties in terms of transformation and similarities, and just starting from a database of thousands of objects and using these similarities and transformation constraints, you end up with a very tight cluster that corresponds to faces. I think this is a cluster corresponding to bodies. There was something else corresponding to bicycles and so on. So you could expect kind of clusters of this type for many classes of objects, although the most obvious, even just from this, would be faces above all. You know, animals come up, chairs, and maybe that's the prediction, there may be clusters that corresponds even to one class of objects. For instance, I've shown these slides of monkeys trained to recognize these paper clips. They were trained for months. It's not something usually you do, but in this monkeys, probably there was a cluster related to those that class of objects. So you can imagine that in the beginning, every cluster is just one example, one view, but then if it's something that you see more often and has certain properties, then they get clustered together. So, okay, this was the end of last class. Now I want to come to something maybe more interesting, mainly because all I spoke about was something that we have more or less already published. This point, let me remind you about evaluations again of the class. And okay, so here is very recent work trying to start to develop some theory that is really missing on deep convolutional learning networks. This would be a kind of extension of the invariant stuff that I described. The kind of question we're interested is, you know, why hierarchies? As I said, that almost everything I described before has to do with invariance in the Huber and Wiesel module. Does not directly address why you need a hierarchy of them. The theory deals with what happens if you have modules in hierarchy, but does not tell you, the ones I described so far, why really you need a hierarchy. Of course, there are some intuitions. One is that in a hierarchy, you may want to, may be helpful if you want to recognize objects and parts, you know, like eyes and nose and hand. You want to recognize them separately and also in conjunction. So for instance, the HMAX hierarchy was essentially layers of AND and OR, where you have the ANDing was at the simple cells level. It was saying this feature, like this vertical bar and this horizontal bar. This is a more complex feature. And the OR was invariance in different position. And then at the next stage, you'd combine this feature, this somewhat invariant feature, in more complex features. That was the kind of idea. There are other reasons for having hierarchy, a kind of intuition of having to do with clutter and having to do with transformation that are not globally affine, but maybe locally affine. But let me, these are intuitions, so let's try to see whether there is something we can prove about all of this. And I mentioned last time there are, I think, two basic questions about deep learning and why it's so successful. One is, you know, why the architecture? Why this particular hierarchical architecture? Why multiple layers and not just one? The second one is why stochastic gradient descent, so back propagation, whatever, works so well. I misspelled SGD, sorry. Mm-hmm. So I don't have much to say about the second one. I'm assuming that essentially SGD works, and still a bit of a magic why, but that's a separate question. So let's assume that you have a learning algorithm that works, and let's see what the architecture can give you. So it's a question of what the architecture in principle could provide, why it can provide more than one hidden layer. So it's this question of why deep versus shallow. And just to fixate the idea, this symbol indicates really a shallow network. Is one of these Huber and Wiesel module, is simple cells and one or more complex cells. And this is a deep architecture in which you're using several of the same modules in a layer. This would be like complex cells in V1, and then complex cells in V2, and so on. Is that clear? Now, the architecture itself, this is a bit idealized. It does not strictly to be, this is a binary tree, really. Or at least I'll look as a binary tree, so you have two inputs in each one of these complex cells, and I'll have a better drawing later, but of course, this is just one of the several possibilities. Usually you have, within here you have a lot of simple cells that get then combined, and one particular example that I think is very simple and more interesting than people thought is when the nonlinearity, so the nonlinearity I will consider is, I'll consider complex cells doing something like what are called ridge approximation. So this is these are continuous functions, and in the case of network, they will be a GI will be VR, this dot product, and this is the linear rectifier. So this means the positive part of what is inside. The negative part is put to zero. So this would be this kind of things. Okay, now suppose that instead of this, the ramp nonlinearity, you have exactly the same thing but the square. Okay. I'll show in a moment that this is equivalent to the absolute value with different parameters. So the positive function, or using the absolute value, is the same. You get piecewise linear splines in either case. Now the absolute value is combining functions like this, centered in BI. The square is combining function like this. So in a sense, not too different. Okay. So in this case, I'll have this kind of functions. And you can imagine that I could have, for instance, a network like this, where I take, you know, square, the square there, and the square of the squares, linear combination of. So networks of this type are easier, polynomial networks are easy to analyze because you are dealing with polynomials at every stage. And you can show that if you have enough units by taking square of linear combination of squares and so on, you can synthesize any polynomial you want, if you're given enough layers. And so, because of Weierstrass theorem, you can approximate arbitrarily well any continuous functions, since you can produce any polynomial you want. Okay, so We'll come back to this because, as I said, it's an interesting proxy and easier to analyze. It may even work as well as what people are using for neural networks. It's unclear. So the kind of notation, graphical notation I'm using is, if we consider, for instance, this, this means that there is a convolution with template, a convolution, I mean a dot product with template. This black piece there is the nonlinearity, the rectifying nonlinearity, for instance. The open circle is pooling. Usually it means, for instance, the max of something like this, max and or sum, or and so anyway, let's just here just to give you an idea. In the case of the splines, linear splines like this, what you get is piecewise linear, so planes, and if you iterate, if you take the, it's like before I was taking the square of square, here it's taking the absolute value, combination of absolute values, I still get planes, linear planes. It's kind of should be that way. And this is this simple statement that linear combination of rectified inputs of this type are equivalent to linear combination of absolute values. And both provide in one dimension, they are really this in one dimension, if you have, this is the interpolation case, you have points, you put one of these absolute values at each of these nodes in X, and you solve for the CI, and you will get something like this, piecewise linear interpolation between points with crazy things that may happen at the boundaries where you don't have points. So this is what both of these are the same. This interpolation scheme you have in the case of interpolation when you solve for the CI to have zero error at the example points. And there is this interesting thing, is sum. So if a node in this networks, like this top node in the Huber and Wiese module, has this form with this nonlinearity, then it's universal. You can approximate any continuous function by itself. This you can prove that in various ways. So this you can approximate any continuous function by itself. In one dimension, if X is one dimension, it's obvious. But in more dimension, when the input X is a vector, it's a bit less obvious, but you can prove it. And in general, if you have operations like this, you can do a lot of things. For instance, this is more of a curiosity. But if you want to compute the max between two numbers. You can do this by a network in which you combine linearly these two inputs, and then you have this rectification, and then the sum. So that's a kind of curious. And if you iterate this little network, you can compute the maximum of n numbers. This is just to say that when you have modules, more in general, this type, they are universal. You can essentially approximate, given enough terms here, you can approximate any continuous function. So that's can do a lot. Any continuous function of, you know, of f of x, where x could be x1 to xn. Okay. So, let's go back to this situation and let's consider mainly, you know, in general, we'll have within this receptive field, this pooling range of this complex cell in A, we'll have many simple cells. But next, I'll mainly consider the extreme case in which there are only two inputs. Before that, these are two results that are essentially well known in the field. One is that if you have, I said already that this is universal. In fact, essentially any function of the dot product here will be universal, apart from polynomials. And this is the one-layer network, one hidden layer. If you say I have multiple layers, then everything which is nonlinear is fine. Even polynomial can give universality. Universality means you can approximate arbitrarily well any continuous function of n variables. And so example of, you know, you can think of this as nodes in a hidden layer, so that you can have many, because you can choose many nonlinearities and they'll work. The kind of best known ones are Gaussian radial basis functions, squares, linear splines, sigmoidal. Anybody was saying something? Okay. Now, there is some complication. This is a parenthesis. So, the first two things here essentially repeat what I was saying. So, and we'll see later how many units you need to have a certain degree of approximation. Because the statement so far has been you can approximate arbitrarily well, but you may need a lot of terms here to do that. There is a strange result by Pincus, is a mathematician approximation theory that relies on an older famous result of Kolmogorov, which solved I think it was the 13 Hilbert conjecture. And that had to do with representing a function of many variables in terms of functions of functions, but all of one variables. And anyway, this result says that if you choose this nonlinearity, it should be like the rectifier value in a special way, it's a very special nonlinearity, then with a two-layer network with a fixed number of units, you can approximate arbitrarily well any continuous function. So it's kind of interesting because people in the deep learning community think that with a shallow network, you may need a lot of units, almost an infinite number, in order to get good approximation for certain function. This shows is not true. You can do a very good job with a two-layer network. However, the sigma is very special, very complicated. Let me skip it. We can come to that later. It's almost a hashing function that would be indexing in the field of all polynomials with rational coefficients. So it's not recommended to be used. Not really. But anyway, so that's a curiosity, an interesting one. Now, I want to address this, essentially this question of whether, so we've seen the deep networks and shallow networks are both universal approximants. So the next question is, maybe deep networks need less units than shallow network when you have to approximate a certain function. Now, the good way to measure complexity, and it's closely related to the number of terms here, but is the VC dimension. VC dimension is a way to measure complexity of networks, if you want. And we know how to obtain from the VC dimension the sample complexity, which is the key part. Because what you really care is the fact that when a network is more complex, it has more parameters intuitively, you need many more examples to train it. Right? So the key problem here is sample complexity. And and so we know the very quantitative relation between VC dimension and sample complexity. And there is this simple theorem by Bartlett that says that if you have a network and if the output of the network is a binary number, 0, 1, then its VC dimension depends by the total number of parameters in the network and by the number of operations that are performed by the nonlinearity. For instance, in the case of the the rectifier nonlinearity, it's only one comparison you need. You know, it's less or greater than a threshold. Okay, so in particular, the VC dimension with this ramp nonlinearity parameterized by n weights, where I count the component of a vector, it will be in the order of the number of units times the number of parameters, weight vector per unit. There is another interesting thing I will I'll use is this order, but let me go to this example to show it. So we are going to compare, this is just to be very concrete. It's a function of eight variables. I can approximate it with the network on the left or the network or hierarchical version of it. Now, order of the network on the left would be the maximum number that each of the red units here, there is one here, maximum number of inputs. So for instance, in the deep network on the right, this is a binary tree, you have two inputs per unit. So the order is two. In the other case, the order is eight. And the idea that we try to prove is that suppose I have a function, so forget the networks for a second, I have a function of eight variables, but this function of eight variables is actually a function of function of functions. It has the structure of that tree, so it's like each of these red dots computes a function of its two variables. And and so question is, the hypothesis, the assumption, quite natural, seems to be that if a network, the deep network, has a structure equivalent to this function, maybe it will be able to implement this function, represent this function, or approximate it better with less units than a shallow network. I know I can do the approximation even with a shallow network because they are both universal. And for instance, that's the case with quadratic splines. There is a relatively old paper a few years ago by Shai, Shalev, Schwartz, in which he considers something similar to this, so squares and then square squares, and he comments that the VC bound for this network is gives you a much lower VC dimension for this network than the VC dimension of having all monomials and then combining them, so a shallow network. Of course, that's true for polynomial of order up there, would be four, I guess, that are produced by that network. So So we are trying to see whether something similar is true also for you know, more general cases, not the square, but for instance, the rectifying nonlinearities. And the answer is yes, that the VC dimension of a shallow network trying to approximate this one increase as this power this is the dimension, and this is the approximation error you want. So, and the dimension can be very large in this networks, if you think about the you know, the ImageNet deep learning networks, the input dimensions is like 10,000 or so at least. Less if you take out the equivalences induced by weight sharing. I'll come to this soon, but in any case, can be very large. So the VC dimension of the shallow network can be very high. And we can do also prove something else, which is maybe more interesting. Suppose that there is a function that has this compositional structure that you want to compute on an image. And these are technical assumption, basically says that the function has to be continuous, only first order continuity. I'm not assuming the derivative is continuous. I'm assuming that the function is bounded and its first derivative is bounded. Then this function, I assume, has a this compositional structure of a binary tree. And then I compute the VC dimension of a deep network with the same structure such that it makes an approximation error epsilon, no larger than epsilon, on that function. And I found out that I find that a shallow network with the same approximation error has this number of units are and here is the number of units of each of the Huber and Wiesel modules in the shallow in the deep network. This is the dimension. And so for instance, in the case of dimension equal 2, in the case that the shallow network has two inputs, of course that becomes equivalent to the deep case, to one unit in the deep case, and then you have that the number of units is the same. So that's sanity check. And otherwise, the VC dimension of the deep network is this order. And you can see that if I plug in a number for the units in the Huber and Wiesel modules, it's because it has to increase with the dimensionality of the inputs, so it's KD, K is a constant. If you plug in, you'll find out that the VC dimension of the shallow network is an exponent in D of K, it's K to the D minus 1, whereas the VC dimension of the deep networks increase as D square. So roughly speaking, we have that for approximating at the same precision a compositional function, a function made of g of g, deep networks are much better in terms of VC dimension than shallow networks, especially for D dimensionality of the input being large.
So by the way, all of this is unpublished and to be checked, you know. This last theorem was yesterday, so that's so there may be some bugs.
Can we rephrase this, translate it into what this is saying is that if data is generated by some hierarchical system, then a deep structure, a deep network is the appropriate.
Yeah, so you are addressing exactly the right question. The question is now, why do we need compositional functions? You know, all of this, all I said is not true for any function. It's true for functions that are made up of g of g of g, okay? Well, g is arbitrary, but like much smaller dimensionality than the resulting f. Okay, so that's exactly the next point. The next point is, why do we need the compositional function in vision or probably signal processing? And there are a couple of answers. Let me skip this first one. Let me come back to this. Let's follow it. So I think there is more than this, but one argument why we need the compositional function is clutter. So actually, it turns out that clutter is everywhere. You can infer something interesting from data about image statistics. And I come back to that later. But let's just for now assume that we have clutter. So, and there are several visual computations that one has to do in the presence of clutter. One is recognizing or identifying an object among clutter. So what is the advantage of a function like this relative to a function like this? Well, one advantage is that if you have two objects, so suppose you want to recognize the letter A, and so B is clutter. If we have a network like this, which is pooling over all this region, then this network is invariant to the position of A. But as soon as there is clutter, that's not true anymore. You know, if all the results in the last lecture, the last class that we had, are based on the assumption that the object is isolated in the pooling region. Because clutter means that it's something that the next time you look may be different, right? So the signature that is computed with pooling, with this algorithm of dot products and pooling and so on, depends on having the same object in some other position, but only this and nothing else, because if you had other things will change. So this suffers from clutter. Whereas this will suffer from clutter, but only within each of this network. The whole system up at the output up there will be affected by this. But if I do some recognition and send the results to memory at each level, then I can avoid clutter. It's not a complete solution, but
And this is kind of the reverse of a theorem I mentioned last time, is that these are object images that are equivalent modulo, say, translation in a fine transformation. And we find it that this is, this was the condition, but this is under the assumption of no clutter. So another argument has to do with this whole and parts. So essentially, you want or small transformation. In fact, that you want a system ideally that can recognize that these are eyes, and then at the same time that this is a face. And the hierarchical network gives you this because you can have can do this in a multiple stages, but this is a more of a it's not clear immediately how much worse you can do this with a shallow network. One thing that is shown here is that there is a transformation of these two faces, which is non is not a global transformation, or just the eyes that are changing their distance. So you cannot expect in general the shallow network to be invariant to this transformation, but the hierarchical network can be. You can show that it can be depending on exactly how it's what is its geometry and where the pattern is. So in summary, we have that both shallow and deep networks can approximate any continuous function, any, you can think of a continuous function, in this case, any operation, any algorithm, reasonable algorithm, on the images. But there are functions that have this compositional structure that are approximated with a much better sample complexity by deep networks than by shallow networks. And then the third leg of the arguments is showing that there are computations in vision, like recognition in clutter, that require compositional functions. And I think especially this last part could be improved in terms of formal or more general results. By the way, I think one point that is coming out is that we are speaking, you know, universal approximation here plays a little bit the role of computability, or it's not exactly, it's not equivalent to Turing computability, but plays a role that you can do almost all operations if you have universal, the property of universal approximation. And then the next question is, you know, how complex is that? So the question of VC dimension, and certain networks can be better than others for certain classes of computations. That's the case of, this would be the case of deep networks for compositional function with relative to the shallow networks. So I told you about the hierarchy. Now, one thing that is, and the previous time I told you about invariance. Now, to put things together, I can tell you what happens to invariance in a hierarchy. We know that if we have those, that algorithm of dot products with templates and pooling, for instance, translations of an image within this pooling range will be invariant here. But what about the next stage and so on? And it's pretty simple what is going on. The idea is that if you have an object which, for instance, is smaller, is contained in one receptive field, then any position here will give the same output. It will be invariant. And the same thing will happen here. Of course, the signal will shift from here to here. And then you have the other case in which you have an object that is larger than this pooling region. And so what happens when you see it next time in another part of the network? So the network will have the correct properties that it will be invariant at certain, there will be a stage where you have invariance. The condition is that the network must be covariant. In other words, you can think of it in terms of a transformation at the image level, like a translation, being mapped into a similar transformation, therefore a translation, at the higher level. And so a translation here should be a translation here. And of course, a translation here may be a zero translation here when the translation is within the pooling region. So I think this tells you what I mean. This is covariance. And you see here what's going on. I have translation at the bottom of the object. I have a translation the layer above, but I have invariant so far at the layer above the layer above. And then now there is more translation here, and there has been some translation on the third layer, but none at the very top. Okay, so you can prove properties, this global, local and global invariance under this property of covariance of the network that the network we're considering have. Can show that the basic properties of the Huber and Wiesel module get preserved in hierarchy. Now, I mean, skip this. Yeah, we have seen this already. This would be a hierarchy that of generic templates, generic networks. The algorithm will be always the same of this dot products, nonlinearity like the rectifying one, and but here the templates would be generic, like Gabor function or similar, used for all inputs, and then later on you have class specific modules, same algorithm, but templates that are exemplars from a class, and this for different classes. Just to finish, this is kind of blue sky, but I think that deep networks may be an interesting model for part of the brain. This is different from what I was thinking 6 months ago. That has to do with, well, there is still this problem, lack of a theory, but the main issue is the one of supervised examples. So the main problem I always thought was the fact that you need millions, a lot of labeled examples. Certainly still a big problem. But it may be possible to have a simple mechanism in the brain of a developing baby or animal, simple mechanism that allow an implicit labeling of the examples. So for instance, you know, I'm here, I'm looking at you and doing this, I'm now getting more than one example, more than one image. I don't know your name, say, but I know it's the same person. So this could be a very usable examples to train. You know, reinforcement learning is another way to do this without somebody that labels. The first one, the example I made with you, has to do probably with time continuity. Nothing big happened in my visual field, no big discontinuities, then everything I see is the same. And this is, by the way, the way we thought about getting templates. Remember I was saying this metaphor of this little story of a baby playing with a toy bicycle in the crib and rotating it, and the fact that you store it as a movie means that you recognize there is no time discontinuity, so they're all frames of the same thing, which is like to transform. So you don't need to tell you this is the bicycle, this is the bicycle, this is the bicycle, this is still the bicycle. So I think this question of whether this may be indeed possible, you know, in a biologically plausible to have a small number of heuristics that allow you to do implicit labeling of objects is an interesting question, because you will not need other, you know, to get labeled images. You'll need to get images but not labeled. So there is some potentially some interesting work to be done in terms of finding heuristics like time continuity and proving that it could be used in real life situations and can provide good enough implicit labels. By the way, this is biologically interesting, but is also interesting in practice. So, you know, I think we are at a stage in which, or in computer science, in which once upon the time we needed programmers. Now we need labelers, which are cheaper, but still a lot of work. You know, you have to label example in order to train a machine to do something, not to program anymore. And it looks like the third phase still to come is the one in which the machines can do most of the work by themselves. You don't need the labelers anymore. And so, in fact, you know, I think that's the... I think this could be, in terms of machine learning, an interesting future. Is actually not big data of it. It's small data, like a child uses, in terms of small labeled data. And so n is the number of labeled or examples, ideally going to be small. Now the kind of supervised learning, which is working well and so on, but is n going to infinity. The more labeled data you have, the better. And so this kind of implicit labels plus this results on symmetry using exploiting invariances and how to get them, you know, are steps toward this next phase of machine learning. Of course, there will be not the only ones, but especially the idea of implicit labeling is something interesting that could help having less need for teams in India to label images, which is what is happening these days. Okay, any questions? This is not only the end of the class, but also the end of the course. So, you know, if you have any feedback, so questions about what I said today, you know, by the way, if you find some mistakes, I'm sure there is some, you know.
Can you say more about approach one?
Approach one?
Yeah.
Which one do you mean? Over there?
One.
Wait. What is approach one?
The next
phase. Down here.
Oh,
n equal one?
Yeah, one.
Oh, this is just... Well, there has been some attempt already many years ago about one-shot learning, one example. I mean, in computer vision, I think, or ideally you would, and I think children are more or less able to do that. You know, you can show to a child, say, a cat and a dog, just one and one. And probably it will be pretty good at recognizing future cats, future meaning dogs will see in the future, even if they are not exactly the same. Is that true?
They may initially confuse cats with things which are similar to cats and define it, but they will get a very good first approach.
Yeah. I remember once a colleague of mine sent around a picture of a panda embracing something and said that his daughter was 3 years old at the time, I think had seen a panda one picture, but she immediately said, oh, that's a panda embracing, you know, the bear. So these are a situation of kind of end going to one, you know. And so I think some of them, like in the panda, it was the case that even if she had seen a panda only in one pose, was able to recognize other poses. The intuition is it's not too dissimilar to a person, and she had templates of other, that's now my explanation, templates of other bodies, other people, other animals, and she could use those as templates in our algorithm to get some invariance to pose. And in fact, I did not speak about it, but we had done some simulations showing that that's possible. So the invariance help you get to this. As I said, it's not the only way. I don't think it can explain all of those examples.
So the way that this would work, would you give your algorithm like an example of something, and then you'd also have to specify a group and a group action for it to learn invariance to?
No, you would have, in the case I mentioned, to be that you have, you show, for instance, the image of a new body, like the panda body. And because there are templates of similar, you know, objects in the same class, bodies of people of similar animals, then just pulling over those. Oh, you assume that, you know, like in the case of Ted's daughter, she has seen other objects, other animals, other people, certainly other people, in different poses. Yeah.
So I'm trying to summarize. Points. Summarize what you said before about the VC dimension and of the shallow and the deep.
Yeah.
So the shallow and the deep structure can give you any decision boundary, any form of decision boundary possible. But the shallow has a larger VC dimension than the deep, so it has a lower, a tighter risk bound. Would that be, so if it does better in the test set?
Yes. So first of all, it has, this holds not for any functions the network can approximate, but only this compositional function. And then the VC dimension is lower in the case of the deep networks, which means you need a smaller number of examples to reach the same performance. Yeah, well, it's not signal. It's in a sense, it's the algorithm that you want to apply, but the function as a computation you are doing on the image, right? Like recognition.
And why would we need a hierarchy? It's just an assumption.
Well, so the hierarchy I was arguing, you need it, for instance, because it helps a clutter. Is one, I would like to have more examples of computations where hierarchies are needed.
But there are deep structures where at the bottom layer you have a fully connected.
That would be shallow, right?
Fully connected. I mean, instead of a convnet is sort of localized.
Well, it's. This is actually the deep one. Let's see. Sorry. Oops. Okay. I wanted to have both. Okay. So this is more like the deep learning networks.
I have the bottom layer that's, you know, looking at the whole.
This is it.
That's shallow, I understand that.
Yeah.
But in the deep layer, it's possible to have the bottom layer, the lower layer, looking at the whole entire, the whole thing, not only the local thing. So you have essentially the same amount of clutter.
Yeah, if you look at everywhere, yes. But, you know, the neural network, especially today, I think the pooling range is becoming smaller and smaller, right? Okay. With the gene. By the way, I did not say this, but if you look at, you know, this was in the case in which the generic case, so I don't assume invariances, but if you assume translation invariance of your computation, or the fact that essentially the statistic of the image is invariant to translation, so there is no need to have a different process from a processor here. All the G, this would be the G, you see, 1.4, 1.3, 1.2, 1.1 are the same. Okay. Are the same parameters, exactly the same. This is weight sharing. Mm-hmm. That corresponds to imposed invariance to shift in this processor. There is no reason why this processor, this function, are different. Same for here, no reason for, what is it, G22 and G21 to be different from each other, they're the same. And then, since you can also, this is a more tricky question, but assume this scaling property, you may be able to assume that this processor and this one are essentially the same. So you get a lot of further reduction in the VC dimension because of that.
My second question was, you mentioned that the of machine learning, next generation machine learning will be based on one example or a small number of examples.
Well, you know, n going to one is, it's partly a joke and it's a limit.
Right.
It does not mean that we have to end up with one. It could be a small number as opposed to infinity.
So what do you think about transfer learning? So you have one domain, you have a classifier in one domain being used for other domain with essentially unlabeled data, or you may have a small number of labeled data.
This is something that also helps doing this. Yeah. As I said, that there are, I don't think this process of going towards much smaller numbers of labeled data is attainable just with one idea. You know, I think there will be a series of things, including, of course, in many situations, prior information about, you know, the data or what you want to do. And anyway, some of these techniques are really, like neural networks, deep learning, are really very generic. You can, many cases, there is more, you know, that you can use. But this is not to say that, you know, the next phase will eliminate the existing one. I think the existing one, using a lot of labeled data, is good results, right? So I expect this to continue for quite some time, 5-10 years. A lot of very interesting applications, very useful applications. I'm just saying this is not how children learn. And so I think it will be possible to have machines that learn more like children do and don't need so many, they still need parents. So we are doing a non-trivial job, you know, in terms of providing feedback and occasionally labels, but I don't think you need to teach a child what is a car by showing 1 million of images of cars and non-cars. Yeah.
Could you explain how to conclude that the sample complexity of deeper networks is smaller than the sample complexity of shallow networks?
Say it again, how to compare?
So how to conclude the sample complexity of one is smaller than the other from the two independent BC bounds? Because they are bounds, right?
Yeah. Sorry, say it again.
So for instance, the BC dimension of an RBF SVM is infinite, but this doesn't mean that you need infinite training samples. It's just an upper bound.
Well, the VC, no, it's not so bad for binary. So the problem with RBF is that you have Gaussian and you cannot use really the VC dimension. You have to use the gamma dimension or Fett-Shatter dimension, whatever it's called, because otherwise you get these pathological cases of VC dimension equal to infinity. But in this case, we don't need to do that because of the specific activation function we are using. Well, what I've been doing is I set a number of units in the deep network. This will mean that there will be a certain error of approximation that I can compute as a degree, and I have an upper bound on this. So this no functions in the set I consider that have a worse error of approximation. I do the same for the shallow one, and I find how many units the shallow one needs to have in terms of the units of the deep one. And then I have two networks, and the deep one has many more units and parameters, and I compute the VC dimension for both. So the dimension is pretty straightforward in this case. I don't think I could stop at the number of units, but sorry?
It is an upper bound designalization. So imagine that one develops a tighter bound, right? And at the end, if you find tighter bounds and there's an error, you see that the bound for the shallow network is smaller than. So they are bounds. It's not, I think the result is, I'm not sure, but I think the result is not saying that the sample complexity is smaller.
Well, but in this case, I think you can find functions for which the bounds would be pessimistic. But if I tell you that there are no functions, you consider a universe of functions, of n variables, continuous with bounded derivatives, and that's the comparison. So I think you will have functions that reach this bound. Yes. when they approximate this class of compositional functions. Yeah.
I have a question. It seems to me that there is inherently something missing here, which is a feedback. So, I mean, the process of learning is a continuous process. So, for example, that example that you mentioned of a girl saying, "Oh, this is Panda."
Yeah.
That girl did see Panda just once, but made an error a couple of times after that, saying that something else is Panda, and her parents actually said, "Oh no, this is bear or something else." So, I mean,
maybe this is what Shimon was saying.
So, I mean, the thing is, I mean, there is a kind of trial and error inherent in learning, and it seems that this is—it's not captured by network.
Well, forget networks. You know, it's nothing to do with networks. It depends how you formalize the process of learning. So in the supervised learning framework, which is what we've been discussing in basically most of the class, you're assuming that you're giving a set of examples, each one with a label, and that's it, right? Now, you know, it's easy to incorporate, to add to this framework situations in which you are correcting other stages. For instance, the network may produce some errors on the training set, and then you may repropose a training set that contains only the wrong examples. And train again, or do some. This is something like AdaBoost is doing. So there are procedures in machine learning to do what you have said. Or, you know, you may mean really the dynamic, simulating the old dynamic, but learning is a big word. There are many, many ways to, So I agree that in biological life, there is, it's a little bit more complicated than just this is this, right?
Yeah. I'm asking because it seems like that's the goal, to get there.
Yeah, that's partly the goal. That's something also, you know, there are various frameworks. You could also have to incorporate other things like what is called active learning. So the child often tries something and like something dangerous, and partly is kind of saying, what is this? You know, asking for a label. You choose the X, and you ask for a label for that, and you may not do it for other ones, right? So that's another area with slightly different problems that people have addressed. It has to do with optimal experimental design, you know. Also, it's another way to reduce the number of labeled examples, because the intuition is that there are many things that you may know they are, and you have eye confidence, and you don't need the label, and certain things you do, right? So, anyway, All right.
One last question.
Yeah.
I hope it's short.
Yeah, but many years ago I wrote a review paper with Steve Smale on machine learning, and one of the questions we asked was, we said it's a puzzle why we have hierarchies in the brain and we don't have hierarchies in machine learning. And now we are in the situation in which we have hierarchies in successful machine learning algorithms like deep learning, but we still don't know why they are there. You know, I was trying to give you some arguments, but we still don't know why they're there. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you for being so patient. Well, perfect.
Yeah, especially to the guys, we are missing several, but Georgios can represent because they have been doing a great job.